Upon that day, either prepare to don the somber habit of a holy nun for disobedience to your mother's will, or wed Demetrius as he would, or on Diana's altar to protest your eye austerity and single life.
Relent, sweet Hermia. Lysander, yield thy grace title to my certain right.
You have her mother's love, Demetrius. Let me have Hermia's. Do you marry her?
Scornful Lysander! True he hath my love, and what is mine, my love shall render him. And she is mine, and all my right before I do state unto Demetrius.
I am, my lord, as well derived as he, as well possessed. My love is more than his. My fortune's every way as fairly ranked, if not with vantages, Demetrius's. And, which is more than all these boasts can be, I am beloved of beauteous Hermia. Why should not I then prosecute my right? Demetrius, I'll avouch it to his head, made love to Nadar's daughter Helena and won her soul. And she, sweet lady, dotes, devoutly dotes, dotes in idolatry upon this spotted and inconstant man.
I must admit, with Demetrius' daughter spoke thereof, and being overfull of self-affairs, my mind did lose it. But, Demetrius, come and kiss. I have some private schooling for you both, and for you, fair Hermia. Look, you arm yourself to fit your fancies to your mother's will. Hippolyta, what's here, my love? Demetrius and Aegeus, go along.
With duty and desire, we follow you.
How now, my love? Why is your cheek so pale? How chance the roses there do fade so fast?
Oh, belike for want of rain, which I can well beteem them from the tempest of my eyes.
I need for aught that I could ever read, could ever hear by tale or history. The course of true love never did run smooth.
No,
but either it was different in blood.
Too high to be enthralled to low.
Or else misgrafted in respective years.
Oh, spite! Too old to be engaged to young.
Or else this through upon the choice of friends.
Oh, hell! To choose love by another's eyes.
Or, if there were a sympathy and choice, war, death, or sickness did lay siege to it, making it momentary as a sound, swift as a shadow, short as any dream. Brief as the lightning in the calling night, that in a spleen unfolds both heaven and earth, and ere a man hath power to say, behold, the jaws of darkness do devour it up. So quick bright things come to confusion.
If then true lovers have been ever crossed, it stands as an edict in destiny. Then let us teach our trial patience as it is a customary cross, as due to love as thoughts and dreams and sighs, wishes and tears, poor fancies followers.
A good persuasion. Therefore, hear me, Hermia. I've a widow aunt, a dowager of great revenue, and she hath no child. From Athens is her house, remote 7 leagues. She respects me as her only son. There, gentle Hermia, may I marry thee. Steal forth thy mother's house tomorrow night, and in the woods, a league without the town. There will I stay for thee.
My good Lysander, I swear to thee by Cupid's strongest bow, by his best arrow with the golden head, by the simplicity of Venus' doves, by that which knitteth souls and prospers loves, by vows more than ever men have broke, in numbers more than ever women spoke, in that place thou hast appointed me, tomorrow truly will I meet with thee.
Keep promise, love. Look, here comes Helena.
Oh, Godspeed, fair Helena, whither away?
Call you me fair? That fair yet unsafe. Loves your fair, oh happy fair! Your eyes are like stars, your tongue sweet air, more jubilant than lark to shepherd's ear. The meat is green, when hawthorn buds appear. My ear should catch your voice, my eye your eye, my tongue should catch your tongue's sweet melody. Were the world's mind, Demetrius, being baited, the rest I'd give to be to you translated. Oh, teach me how you look, and with what art you sway the motion of Demetrius' heart.
I frown upon him, yet he loves me still.
Oh, that your frowns would teach my smile such skill.
I give him curses, yet he gives me love.
Oh, that my prayers could such affection move.
The more I hate him, the more he follows me.
The more I love, the more he hateth me.
His folly, Helena, is no fault of mine.
None but your beauty. Would that fault were mine.
Take comfort. He no more shall see my face. Lysander and myself will fly this place.
Helen, to you our minds we will unfold. Tomorrow night, when Phoebe doth behold her silvery visage in the watery glass, decking with liquid pearl the bladed grass, a time that lover's flight still conceal, through Athens' gates have we devised to steal.
And in the wood, where often you and I, upon sweet primrose beds we're wont to lie, emptying our bosoms of our counsel sweet. There my Lysander and myself shall meet. Farewell, sweet play fellow. Pray thou for us, and good luck grant thee thy Demetrius.
Some tears in the true performing of it, if I do it Let the audience look to their eyes. I will move stones. I will condole in some measure. Yet my chief humor is for a tyrant. I could play Heracles rarely, or a part to tear a cat in to make all split. The raging rocks and shivering shocks shall break the locks of prison's gate, and Phoebus's car shall shine from far and make and mar the foolish fates. This was lofty. Now name the rest of the players. This is Heracles' vein, a tyrant's vein. A lover is more condoling.
Francis Fluth, the bellows mender.
Here, Peter Quince.
Francis Fluth, you must take Thisbe on you.
What is Thisbe, a wandering knight?
It is the lady that Pyramus must love.
Nay, Faith, let me not play, woman. I have a beard coming.
That's all one you shall. Place it in ask. You may speak as small as you will.
And I may wear a mask. Let me play Thisbe too. I will speak in a monstrous little voice. Well, proceed.
Robin Starling the tailor.
Here, Peter Quince.
Robin Starling, you must play Thisbe's mother. Tom Snap the Tinker.
Here, Peter Quince!
You, Pyramus's father, myself, Thisbe's father, Snug the Joiner, you, the lion's part, and I hope here is a play fit to
you. Have you the lion's part written? Are you, Thisbe, given me for a slow study?
You may do an extempore, for it is nothing but roaring.
And I may play the lion! I will roar! That I will do any man's heart good to hear me. I will roar that the Duke may say, let him roar again. Let him roar again.
And you should do it too terribly that you in front of the duchess and the ladies, that they would shriek, and that were enough to hang us all.
That would hang us, every mother's
son. Oh, I grant you, friends, if you should fright the ladies out of their wits, they would have no more discretion but to hang us all. But I will aggravate my voice, that I will roar you as gently as any sucking dove. I will roar you toward any nightingale.
You can play no part but Pyramus, for Pyramus is a sweet-faced man, a proper man, as one shall see on a summer's day, a most lovely, gentleman-like man. Therefore, you must needs play Pyramus!
Well, I will undertake it. Oh, what beard am I best to play it in?
Why, what you will.
I will discharge it in either your straw-colored beard, your orange-tawny beard, your purple ingrain beard.
Masters, here are your parts, and I request you, entreat you, and desire you to con them by tomorrow night, and meet me in the palace wood. A mile down the town, by moonlight, there will we rehearse. For if we meet in the city, we shall be dogged with company, and our devices known. In the meantime, I will draw a bill of property such as our play wants. I pray you, fail me not.
And we will meet, and there we may rehearse, most obscenely and courageously. Take pains, be perfect. Adieu.
At the Duke's Oak we meet.
Thank you. hill, over dale, through brush, through briar, over park, over pale, through flood, through fire.
I do wander everywhere, swifter than the moon's spear, and I do serve the fairy queen to do her orbs upon the green.
The cowslips tall, her pensioners see, in their gold coat spots you see, those be rubies, fairy favors, and their freckles flood their saviors. Let's go seek some dujar here, and your pearl in every cowslip's ear.
Farewell, thou law of spirits, all be gone, our queen and all our elves come here anon.
The king doth keep his revels here tonight. Take heed, the queen come not within his sight, for Oberon is passing,
fell in wrath,
because that she, as her attendant hath, a lovely boy, stolen from an Indian king. She never had so sweet a changeling, and jealous Oberon would have the child, none of his train to trace the forests wild. But she perforce withholds the loved boy, crowns him with flowers, and makes him all her joy. And now they never meet, in grove or green, by fountain clear or spangled starlight sheen. But they do swear that all their elves for fear creep into acorn cups and hide them there.
Either I mistake your shape in making quite, or else you are that shrewd and knavish sprite called Robin Goodfellow. Are not you he that frights the maidens of the villagery?
Skim milk can sometimes labor in the kern, and moodless makes the breathless housewife cheer.
And sometimes make the drink to bear no barn, mislead night wanderers laughing at their harm. Those that hobgoblin call you and sweet pup, you do their work and they shall have good luck.
Are not you he? Thou speakest right. I am that merry wanderer of the night. I jest to Oberon and make him smile, when I have fat and bean-fed horse beguile, neighing in the likeness of a filly foal. The wisest aunt, telling the saddest tale, sometime for 3 foot storm has taketh me. Then slip I from her bum, down comes she, and Taylor cries and falls into a cough. And then the whole choir hold their hips and laugh and wax in their mirth and knees and swear. Oh, a merrier hour was ne'er wasted there.
The blue fairy, here comes Oberon.
And here my mistress,
would that he were gone.
Whom he ravished, and make it to the fair Igo break his faith with Ariadne and Antiopa?
These are the forgeries of jealousy. And never, since middle summer spring, met we on hill or dale, forest or mead, by paved fountain or rushy brook, or in the beached margin of the sea, to dance our ringlets to the whistling wind. But with thy brawls thou hast disturbed our sport. Therefore the winds have sucked up from the sea contagious fogs, which falling on the land have every river made so proud that they have overborne their continents. The ox therefore hath stretched his yoke in vain, the plowman lost his sweat, and the green corn hath rotted ere its youth obtained a beard. The fold stands empty in the drowned field, and the crows are fatted with the murrying flock. The nine men's horse is filled up with mud, and the quaint mazes in their wanton green, for lack of tread, are undistinguishable. The human mortals want their winter here. No night is now with hymn or carol blessed. Therefore the moon, the governess of floods, pale in
her anger washes all the air. The rheumatic diseases do abound. At the rose's distemperature, we see the seasons alter. Hoary-headed frost far in the fresh lap of the crimson rose, and on old Heim's thin and icy crown, an odorous chaplet of sweet summer buds is, as in mockery, set. The spring, the summer, the child and autumn, the angry winter change their wonted liveries, and the mazed world, by their increase, now knows not which is which. And the same progeny of evils comes from our debate, from our dissension. We are their parents and original.
Do you amend it then? It lies in you. Why should Titania cross her Oberon?
Well, you will never have my changeling child. His mother was a votress of my order, and in the spiced Indian air by night, full often has she gossiped by my side, and sat with me on Neptune's yellow sands, marking the embarked traders of the flood, which we have laughed to see the sails conceive and grow big-bellied in the wanton wind, which she, with pretty and swimming gait following, would imitate, her womb then rich with my own squire, and sail upon the land and return again, as from a voyage rich with merchandise. But she being mortal, that boy did die, and for her sake do I rear up the boy, and for her sake I will not part with him.
How long within this wood intend you stay?
Perchance till after Theseus' wedding day. If you will see our moonlight revels and go round, go with us. Not shun me, and I will spare your haunt.
Give me that boy, and I'll go with thee.
Not for thy fairy kingdom. Fairies away, we shall chide downright if I longer stay.
Well, go thy way. Thou shalt not from this grove till I torment thee for this injury. My gentle pluck, come hither. Thou remember since once I sat upon a promontory and heard a mermaid on a dolphin's back, uttering such dulcet and harmonious breath that the rude sea grew civil at her song, and certain stars shot madly from their spheres to hear the sea maid's music.
I remember.
That very time I saw, but thou couldst not. Flying between the cold moon and the earth, Cupid all armed, a certain aim took at a fair vestal throne by the west, and he loosed his love shaft smartly from his bow, as it should pierce 100,000 hearts. Yet I might see young Cupid's fiery shaft quenched in the chaste beams of the watery moon. And the imperial voters passed on and made a meditation fancy free. Yet marked I where the bolt of Cupid fell. It fell upon a little western flower before a mouth white, now purple with love's wound. And maidens call, love and idleness. Fetch me this flower, the herb I shewed thee once. The juice of it on sleeping eyelids laid will make or man or woman madly dote upon the next live creature that it sees. Fetch me this herb, and be thou here again, ere the leviathan can swim a leap.
Oh, put a girdle round about the earth in 40 minutes!
Having once this juice, I'll watch Titania when she is asleep, and drop the liquor of it on her eyes. And the next thing then she waking looks upon, be it on lion, bear, or wolf, or bull, on meddling monkey, or on busy ape, she shall pursue it with the soul of love. And ere I take this charm from off her sight, as it be taken with another herb, I'll make her render up her patient. But who comes here? I'm invisible, and I'll overhear their conference.
Cannot love you.
And even for that, do I love you the more? I am your spaniel, and to me to follow you. What worser place can I beg in your love, and yet a place of high respect with me, than to be used but as you use your dog?
Tell not too much the hatred of my spirit, for I am sick when I look on you.
I am sick when I look not on you.
You impeach your modesty too much. To leave the city and commit yourself into the hands of one that loves you not. To trust the opportunity of night and the ill counsel of a desert place with the rich worth of your virginity.
Your virtue is my privilege. For that it is not night when I see your face. Therefore I think I am not in the night, nor doth this wood lack worlds of company. But you, my respect, are all the world. How can it be said that I am alone, and all the world is here to look on me?
I will not stay thy questions. Let me go. For if thou follow me, do not believe I will do thee mischief in the wood.
Hi, in the temple, in the town, the field. You do me mischief, by Demetrius! Your wrongs do set a scandal on my sex. We cannot fight for love as men may do. We should be wooed, and we're not made to woo! Oh, I'll follow thee, make a heaven of hell, to die upon the hand I love so well!
Fairly well, nymph, ere you leave this grove, thou shalt fly him, and he shall seek thy love. Welcome, wanderer, hast thou the flower there?
There it is.
I pray thee, give it to me. I know a bank where the wild thyme blows, where ox lips and the nodding violet grows, quite over canopied with luscious woodbine, with sweet musk roses, and with eglantine. There sleeps Titania some time of the night, lulled in these flowers with dances in delight, and there the snake throws her enameled skin, weed wide enough with to wrap a fairy in. With the juice of this, I'll streak her eyes, and make her full of hateful fantasies. Take thou some of it, and seek through this grove, a sweet Athenian lady's in love with a disdainful youth. Anoint his eyes, but do it when the next thing he espies may be thy lady. Thou shalt know the man by the Athenian garments he hath on. Affect it with some care that he may prove more fond on her than she upon her love. And look thou meet me ere the first cock crow.
Fear not, my lord. Your servant shall do so.
Near unfair.
when thou dost wait. Good for thy true love take. Love and languish for his sake. Be it ounce or cat or bear, hard or poor with bristled hair, and thy eye that shall appear when thou wake. It is thy dear. Wake when some vile thing is near.
Tarry for the comfort of the day.
Be it so, Lysander, find you out of bed, for I upon this bank will rest my head.
One turf shall serve as pillow for us both, one heart, one bed, two bosoms, and one troth.
Oh, nay, good Lysander, for my sake, my dear, lie further off yet, do not lie so near.
Oh, take the sense sweet of my innocence. Love takes the meaning in love's conferences. I mean that my heart unto yours is knit, so that but one heart we can make of it. Two bosoms interchange with an oath, so then two bosoms and a single troth. Then by your side no bedroom me deny, for lying so, Hermia, I do not lie.
Oh, Lysander riddles very prettily. Now much beshrew my manners and my pride if Hermia meant to say that Lysander lied. But, gentle friend, for love and courtesy, lie further off yet, in human modesty. So far be distant. And good night, sweet friend. Thy love ne'er alter till thy sweet life end.
Amen, amen to that fair prayer, say I. Then end life when I am loyalty. Here is my bed. Sleep give thee all his rest.
With half that wish, the wisher's eyes be pressed.
Lord, what though? Hermia still loves you, then be content.
Content with Hermia? No. I do repent the tedious minutes I with her spent. Not Hermia, but Helena I love. Who would not change a raven for a dove? The will of man is by his reason swayed, and reason says you of the worthier maid. Things growing are not ripe in another season, so I, being young, till now ripe not to reason. And touching now the point of human skill, reason becomes the marshal to my will, and leads me to your eyes where I overlook love's stories written in love's richest book.
Oh, wherefore was I to this King Godfrey born? When at your hand did I deserve this scorn? It's not enough, young man, that I never, no, nor ever can deserve a sweet look from Demetrius' eye. But you must plow my insufficiency. You do me wrong, but sooth you do. Such a disdainful man of me to woo. If you will, of course I must confess. Stop your lord and more true gentleness.
She sees not Hermia. Hermia, sleep thou there. Never miss thou come Lysander near. And all my powers to dress your love and might, to honor Helen, and to be her knight.
Help me, Lysander! Help me, Paul! Do thy best to pluck this crawling serpent from my breast! Ay, me! Oh, for pity! Oh, what a dream was here! Lysander, look how I do quake with fear! Methought a serpent eat my heart away, and you said, smiling at his cruel prey! Lysander? Removed? Lysander? Lord? Alack, where are you? Speak, and if you hear, speak of all loves! Oh, I swoon almost with fear. No? Then I will perceive you all that night! Either death or you, I'll find immediately!
Then you must name his name, and tell them plainly he is snug the joiner.
Well, it shall be so, but there is two hard things it is to bring the moonshine into a chamber, for, you know, Pyramus and Thisbe meet by moonlight.
Doth the moonshine the night we play our play?
A calendar! Look in the almanac! Find out moonshine! Find out moonshine! May you leave a casement of the great chamber window where we play our play open, and the moon may shine in at the casement.
Aye, or else one must come with a bush of thorns and a lantern, say he comes to disfigure or to present the person of moonshine. Then there's another thing. We must have a wall in the great chamber, for Pyramus and Thisbe, says the story, did talk through the chink of a wall.
You can never bring in a wall! What say you, Bottom?
Some man or other must present wall, and let him have some plaster or some loam or some rough cast about him to signify wall. And let us hold his fingers thus, and through this cranny make Pyramus and Thisbe whisper.
If that may be, then all is well. Come, sit down, every mother's son, rehearse your part. Pyramus, you begin. You have spoken your speech, enter into that break, and so everyone according to his cue.
What heavenly homespuns have we swaggering here, so near the cradle of the fairy queen? What? A playtor, albeit auditor, an actor too, perhaps, if I see cause.
Speak, Pyramus, Thisbe, therefore.
Oh, Thisbe, the flowers of odious savor sweet.
Odors,
savor sweet, so hath thy breath. Oh, but hark, a voice, stayest thou but here a while, and by I will to thee appear.
Stranger Pyramus than airplane here.
Must I speak now?
Aye, very must you. For you must understand he was to see a noise that he heard, and is to come again.
Most radiant Pyramus, most lily-white of hue, of color like the red rose on triumphant bride, most frisky juvenile and eke most lovely Jew, as true as truest horse that yet would never tire, I'll meet thee, Pyramus, at Minnie's tomb.
Not if this true man, why you must not speak that yet. You speak all your parts at once, cues and all. Pyramus, enter! Your cue is past. It is never tire!
As true as truest horse.
As true as truest horse. It would never tire.
If I were fair, please be, I were only thine.
Oh, monstrous, oh, strange. We are haunted! Pray, masters! Fly, masters! Help!
I'll follow you! I'll lead you about around, through bog, through bush, through brake, through briar. Sometime a horse I'll be, sometime a hound, a hog, a headless bear, or sometime a fire, and neigh and bark, and grunt, and roar, and burn, like horse, hound, hog, bear, fire at every turn!
This is a knavery of them to make me afear!
Oh, Bottom! Thou art changed! What do I see on thee?
What do you see? You see an ass head of your own, do you?
Oh, bless thee, Bottom, bless thee. Thou art
see their knavery. This is to make an ass of me, to frighten me if they could. But do what they can, I will not stir from this place. I will walk up and down here and I will sing, and that will show them I am not afraid. The awesome cock so black of hue and orange tawny bill, the throstle with his nose so true, and then with little quill.
What angel wakes me from
my side? The finch, the sparrow, and the lock, the plain song cocoa gray, whose not full many a man doth mock, and dare not answer me.
I pray thee, gentle mortal, sing again. Mine ear is much enamored to thy note, so is mine eye enthralled to thy shape, and thy fair virtue's force, perforce doth move me, on the first view, to say, to swear, I love thee.
Oh, methinks, mistress, you should have little reason for that, to say the truth. Love and reason keep little company with each other nowadays. More so the pity that some honest neighbors will not make them friends. Nay, hey,
on! Oh, thou art as wise as thou art beautiful.
Not so, neither. But if I have wit enough to get out of this wood, I have enough to serve mine own.
Out of this wood do not desire to go. Thou shalt remain here whether thou wilt or no. I am a spirit of no common race. The summer still doth tend upon my state, and I too love thee. Therefore go with me, and I shall give thee fairies to attend on thee, and they shall fetch thee jewels from the deep, and sing while thou on pressed flowers dost sleep. And I shall purge thy mortal grossness so, that thou shalt like an airy spirit go. He's blossom, cobweb, moth, and mustard seed.
Ready.
And I.
Where shall we go?
Be kind and courteous to this gentleman. Feed him with apricocks and dewberries, with purple grapes, green figs, and mulberries, and the honey bags steal from the humble bees, as the night tapers cross their waxen thighs, and light them at the fiery glowworm's eyes. To have my love to bed and to arise, and pluck the wings from painted butterflies, fan the moonbeams from his sleeping eyes. Nod to her mouths and do him courtesies.
Hail, mortal!
Hail!
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 I cry your worship's mercy, partly. I beseech your worship's name.
Cobweb!
Oh, good master Cobweb. If I cut my finger, I shall make bold with you. I shall desire your more acquaintance, good master Cobweb. Your name, honest gentleman.
Peace Blossom.
Good Master Peas Blossom, commend me to Mistress Squash, your mother, and Mr. Peascod, your father. I shall desire your more acquaintance too, good Master Peas Blossom. Oh, your name, honest gentleman.
Mustard Seed.
Good Master Mustard Seed, I know your patience well. I shall desire your more acquaintance too, good Master Mustard Seed.
Come, lead him to my bower. The moon methinks looks but with a watery eye, and when she weeps every little flower, lamenting some enforced chastity. Tie up my love's tongue, bring him silently. Anybody find me?
Somebody, somebody, somebody.
that's not enough.
So if you will, please fall in love with me.
Be awake, and what it was next came in her eye, which she must dote on an extremity. Here comes my messenger. How now, mad spirit? What night rule now about this haunted grove?
My mistress with a monster is in love, near to her close and consecrated bower, while she was in her dull and sleeping hour. A crew of hatches, rude mechanicals that work for bread upon Athenian stalls, were met together to rehearse a play intended for the great Theseus' nuptial day. The shallow thick skin of that barren sort, who Pyramus presented in his sport, forsook his scene and entered in a break, when I did him at this advantage take. An ass's knoll I fixed upon his head, anon his thespian must be answered, and forth my mimic comes, when they him spy, like the wild geese that the creeping fowler eye, or russet painted chops, many in sort, rising and calling with the gun's report, sever themselves and madly sweep the sky. So at his sight, away his fellows fly, for briars and thorns at their apparel snatch, some sleeves, some hats, for yielders all things catch, and led them on in his distracted fear, and left sweet Pyramus translated there. When in that moment, so it came to pass, Titania waked, and straightway loved an ass.
This falls out better than I could devise. But hast thou yet lashed the Athenian's eyes with the love juices I did bid thee do?
I took him sleeping. That is finished too. And the Athenian woman by his side. So when he waked, of course she must be eyed.
Stand close. This is the same Athenian.
Oh, well, this is the woman, but not this the man.
Oh, why would you give the most you so late breath so bitter on your bitter foe?
Now I have a child, but I should use thee worse. For thou, I fear, hast given me cause to curse. If thou hast slain my Sander in his sleep, being horseshoes and blood, plunge in the deep and kill me too. The sun was not so true unto the day as he to me. Would he have stolen away from sleeping Hermia? Oh, it cannot be, but thou hast murdered him. So should a murderer look so dead, so grim.
So should the murdered look, and so should I, pierced through the heart with your stern cruelty. Yet you, the murderer, look as bright, as clear as yonder Venus in her glimmering sphere.
What's this to my Lysander? Where is he? Ah, good Demetrius, wilt thou give him me?
Rather give his carcass to my hounds.
Out, dog! Out, cur! Thou driest me past the bounds of maiden patience. Henceforth, never be numbered amongst men. Oh, once tell true, tell true, even for my sake. Durst thou look upon him being awake, and hast thou killed him sleeping? Oh, brave touch! Could not a worm, an adder, do so much? An adder did it for a doubler tongue than thine, thou serpent, never adder stung.
You spend your passion on a misprized mood. I am not guilty of Lysander's blood, nor is he dead brought, that I can tell.
I pray thee, then, tell me that he is well.
If I could, what should I get there for?
Oh, the privilege never to see me more. And from thy hated presence part I so, see me no more, whether he be dead or no. Yah!
There is no following her in this fierce vein. Be here therefore for a while, I shall remain.
Now it's time to say goodnight.
Sleep tight, dream sweet dreams, morning.
What hast thou done? Thou hast mistaken quite, and laid the love juice on some true love's sight? About the wood go swifter than the wind, and Helena of Athens look thou fine. All fancy sick she is, and pale of cheer, with sighs of love that cost the fresh blood dear. By some illusion, look thou bring her here. I'll charm his eyes against she do appear.
I go, oh, look how I go, swifter than arrow from the Tartar's bow.
Flower of this purple dye, hit with Cupid's archery, sink an apple of his eye, when his love he doth sigh. Let her shine as gloriously as the Venus of the sky, when thou wakest if she be by, beg of her for remedy.
Captain of our merry band, Helena is here at hand, and the youth, mistook by me, a pleading for a lover's fee. Shall we their fond pageant see? Lord, what fools these mortals be!
Stand aside. The noise they make will cause Demetrius to awake.
Then will two at once woo one. This must needs be sport alone. For these things do best please me that we fall preposterously.
There to remain.
Helen, it is not so.
Disparage not the faith you dost not know. Lest to thy peril thou abide, dear, look where thy love comes. Yonder is thy dear.
Oh, thou art not by mine eye, Lysander found. Mine ear I think it brought me to thy sound. But why unkindly didst thou leave me so?
Why should he stay whom love doth press to go?
What love could press Lysander from my side?
Lysander's love thou not let him bind. Fair Helena, who more gilds the night than all you fiery oaths and eyes of light. Why seekest thou me? Could not this make thee know? The hate I bear thee made me leave thee so.
You speak not as you think you cannot be.
Low, she is one of this confederacy! Now I perceive them conjoined all three! Imagine this false sport in spite of me! Injurious Hermia, most ungrateful maid! Have you conspired? Have you at least contrived to bait me with this foul derision? Is all the counsel we two have shared? The sisters' vows, the hours we have spent when we have chid the hasty foot of time for parting us? Oh, is it all forgot? School day friendships? Childhood innocence? We, Hermia, like two artificial gods, have with our needles created one flower, both on one sampler sitting on one cushion, both warbling one song, both in one key. As if our hands, sides, voices, and minds have been incorporate. So we grow together, like to a double cherry, seemingly parted with an union and partition. Two lovely berries molded on one stem, so two silly bodies, but one heart. And will you rent our ancient love asunder to join these men? Thorning your poor friend? Tis not friendly, tis not maidenly. Our sex, as well as I, may chide you for it. Although I alone do feel the injury.
I am amazed at your passionate words. I scorn you not, though it seems you scorn me.
Have you not set Lysander as a scorn to follow me and praise my eyes and face? Demetrius, other love, Demetrius. We have been now to spurn me with his foot. Oh, my goddess, nymph, divine, rare, precious, celestial. Oh, wherefore he speaks this to her he hates? And wherefore not Lysander deny your love so rich within his soul? And tender me, forsooth, affection? By your setting on, by your consent, I be not so ingrace as you, so hung upon with love, so fortunate, yet miserable most, love unloved. This you should pity rather than despise.
I understand not what you mean by this.
I do persever. Sad looks. They mouth upon me when I turn my back, wink each at other, sweet jest up. This for well-caring shall be chronicled. If you have any pity, grace, or manners, you would not make me such an argument. But fare ye well. Tis partly my own fault. Death. Perhaps shall remedy.
Stay, gentle Helena, hear my excuse, my love, my life, my soul. Fair Helena!
Excellent, we cannot scorn her so!
If she cannot treat, I can compel. Thou canst compel no more than she treat. Thy threats have no more strength than her weak prayers. Helen, I love thee, by my life I do. I swear by that which I will lose for thee, to prove him false that says I love thee not.
I say I love thee more than he can do.
Lysander, where to tempt all this?
Wait, you Ethiop!
No, no, he'll seem to break loose. Take on as you would follow, yet come not. You're a tame man, go!
Ah! Hang off, thou cat! Thou bird, by a thing, let loose, or I'll shake thee for me like a serpent.
Ah! Why have you grown so rude? What changes this sweet love?
Thy love! Out, tawny Tartar, out! Out, love's medicine, hated potion, hence!
Even not jest!
Yes, Susan, so do you!
Demetrius, I will keep my word with thee!
I would! I had your bond, for I perceive a weak bond holds you. I'll trust not your word!
What? Should I hurt her? Strike her? Kill her dead? Although I hate her, I'll not harm her so! Never did desire to see thee more, therefore be out of hope, of question, of doubt. Be certain, nothing truer, 'tis no jest.
that I do hate thee and love Helena.
Oh, me. You juggler. You kicker blossom. You thief of love. What? Have you come by night and stolen my love's heart from him?
Fine, Ephage. Have you no modesty? No maybe, no touch of bashfulness. Well, will you tear impatient answers from my gentle soul?
Fine, you counterfeit. You puppet, you.
Puppet? Why so? Aye, that way goes the game. Now I perceive that she hath made compare between our statures. She hath urged her height, and with her personage, her tall personage, her height pursued, she hath prevailed with him. And are you grown so high in his esteem because I am so dwarfish and so low? How low am I, thou painted thing?
Mine are quicker for a fray. My legs are longer, though.
Frost, committest thy knaveries willfully?
You leave me, King of Shadows. I mistook. Did not you tell me I should know the man by the Athenian garment he had on? So far blameless proves my enterprise that I have anointed an Athenian's eyes. And so far am I glad it did so sort, for this their jangling I esteem a sport.
Thou seest these lovers seek a place to fight. I therefore, Robin, overcast the night. The starry welkin covered thou anon, with drooping fog as black as Acheron, and leave these testy rivals so astray that one come not within another's way. And like to Lysander, sometime frame thy tongue, then stir Demetrius up with bitter wrong. And from each other look thou be them thus, till o'er their brows the counterfeiting sleep, with leaden legs and batting wings doth creep. Then crush this herb in the Lysander's eyes, whose liquor hath this virtuous property, to take from thence all air of his might, and make his eyeballs roll with wanted sight. When they next wake, all this derision shall seem a dream and fruitless vision.
My fairy lord, this must be done with haste, for night's swift dragons cut the clouds full fast, and yonder shines Aurora's harbinger, at whose approach ghosts, wandering here and there, troop home to churchyards. Damned spirits all, that in crossways and floods have burial, already to their wormy beds are gone, for fear lest day should look their shames upon.
But we are spirits of another sort. I with the morning's love have oft made sport, and like a forester, the groves may tread, even till the eastern gate, all fiery red, opening on Neptune with fair blessed beams, turns to yellow gold his salt green streams. But notwithstanding, haste make no delay, we may effect this business yet ere day.
Up and down, up and down, I will lead them up and down. I am feared in field and town, goblin, lead them up and down. Here comes one.
Where art thou, proud Demetrius? Speak thou now.
Here, villain, drawn and ruddy, where art thou?
I will be with thee straight.
Follow me then, to play the ground.
Lysander, speak again! Thou run away, thou coward, art thou fled? Speak in some bush where dost thou hide thy head?
Thou coward, art thou bragging to the stars? Telling the bushes thou look'st for wars, and wilt not come? Come, recreant, come, thou child, I'll whip thee with a rod. He is defiled that draws a sword on thee.
Yea, art thou there?
Follow my voice, try no man from here.
He goes before me and still tears me on. When I come where he calls, then he is gone. The villain is much lighter heel than I. Followed fast, but faster he did fly than fallen my dark uneven way. Here will rest me. Come, thou gentle day.
Oh, coward, why comest thou not?
Find me if thou darest, for I will what? Thou runs before me, shifting in every place, and dares not stand. Who look me in the face, where art thou now?
Come hither, I'm here.
Nay, then thou mockest me. Thou shalt abide this dear, if ever I thy face by daylight see. Now go, faintness constraineth me, to measure out my length on this cold bed. By day's approach, look to be visited.
Oh, weary night, oh, long and tedious night. Thy hours shine comforts from the east, that I be back to Athens by daylight. Who these that my poor company detest? Sleep, that sometimes shuts on sorrow's eyes, steal me away from my own company.
Blossom.
Ready.
Scratch my head, please, Blossom. Where is Monsieur Cobweb?
Ready.
Oh, Monsieur Cobweb, good Monsieur. Get your weapons in your hand and kill me a red-hipped humblebee on top of a thistle. And good Monsieur, bring me the honey bag. Where is Monsieur Mustard Seed?
Ready.
Oh, Monsieur Mustard Seed, good Monsieur, give me your meat. Monsieur, pray you leave your courtesy. Good Monsieur.
What's your will?
Nothing but to help Cavalry Cobweb to scratch. I must to the barber's, Monsieur, for methinks I am marvelously hairy about the face. And I am such a tender ass. If my hair be but tickle, I must scratch. Let's have the tongues and the bones.
Or say, sweet love, what thou desirest to eat.
Truly a peck of provender. I could munch on good dry oats. Methinks I have a great desire to a bottle of hay. Good hay, sweet hay, hath no fellow.
I have a venturous fairy who shall seek the squirrel's hoard and fetch thee new nuts.
I have rather a handful or two of dry peas, but pray you, let none of your people stir me. I have an exposition of sleep come upon me.
Sleep thou, and I will wind thee in my arms. Fairies be gone, and be always away. So doth the woodbine, the sweet honeysuckle gently entwist. The female ivy so enrings the barky fingers of the elm. Oh, how I love thee, how I dote on thee.
Welcome, good Robin. Seest thou this sweet sight? Her dotage I do begin to pity, for meeting her of late behind the wood, seeking sweet favors from this hateful fool. I did upbraid her and fall out with her, when I had at my pleasure taunted her, and she in mild terms begged my patience. I then did ask of her her changeling child, and her fairy sent to bear him to my bower in fairyland. And now I have the boy. I'll undo this hateful imperfection of her eyes. And gentle Puck, take this transformed scalp from off the heavy Athenian swain, that he awaking when the others do, may all to Athens back again repair, and think no more of this night's accidents. But first, I'll release the fairy. Be'st thou wast wont to be, see'st thou wast wont to see, Dian's bud o'er Cupid's flower, hath such force and blessed power. And I, my Titania, wake you, my sweet queen.
My Oberon, what visions have I seen? Methought I was enamored of an ass.
There lies your love.
Oh! How came these things to pass? Oh, how mine eyes do loathe his visage now.
Silence while. Robin, take off this head. Titania, music call and strike more dead than common sleep of all these five descents.
Music, ho, music such as charm and sleep, when thou wakest with thine own fool's eyes peep.
Sound music, come my queen and take hands with me, and rock the ground where only sleepers be. Now thou and I are noon amenity, and will tomorrow midnight solemnly dance, and Duke Theseus's house triumphantly. And there shall the pairs of faithful lovers be wedded, with Theseus all in jollity.
Fairy king, attendant mark, I do hear the morning lark.
Then, my queen, in silence sad, trip we after the night's shade. We the globe can compass soon, swifter than the wandering moon.
Come, my lord, and in our flight, tell me how it came this night, that I sleeping here was found with these mortals on the ground.
Walk in the street, you in your worn out jeans, get up and this is how it ought to be. Laughing on a park bench, thinking to myself, hey, isn't this easy? But smile and the light up this whole town. I haven't seen it in a while since you brought you down. Say you're fine, I know you better than that. Hey, what you doing with a girl like that? She
Sparta.
But soft! What nymphs are these?
My lord, this is my daughter who are asleep. And this Lysander. This Demetrius is. And this Helena, old Nadar's Helena. I wonder of their being here together.
No doubt they rose up early to observe the rite of May. And hearing our intent, came here and grace our solemnity. Good morrow, friends. St. Valentine is past. Begin these woodbirds, but to couple now.
Pardon, my lord.
I pray you all, stand up. I know you two are rival enemies. How come this gentle concord in the world that hatred is so far from jealousy, to sleep by hate and fear no enmity?
My lord, I shall reply amazedly. Half sleep, half waking, but as yet I swear, cannot truly say how I came here. But as I think, for truly would I speak. And now do I bethink me, so it is, I came with Hermia hither. Our intent was to be gone from Athens, where we might, without the peril of the Athenian law.
Oh, enough, my lord, enough! I beg the law upon his head! They would have stolen away, they would, Demetrius, thereby to have defeated you and me. You of your wife, and me of my consent, that she should be your wife!
My lord, fair Helen told me of their stealth, of their purpose under this wood. I in fury could have followed them. Fair Helen unfancy following me. But, my good lord, I wot not by what power, by some power it is. My love to Hermia melted as the snow seems to me now. The remembrance of an idle god in which my childhood I did dote upon. All of the faith, the virtue of my heart, the object, and the pleasure of mine eye is only one. As in sickness, I did loathe this food, but as in health, it did come to my natural taste. Now I do wish it, love it, long for it, and will evermore be true to it.
You have fortunately met. Aegeus, I will overbear your will. Away with us to Athens. Come, Hippolyta.
These things seem small and indistinguishable.
Methinks I see things with parted eye when everything seems double.
So methinks I come to Demetrius like a jewel, mine own and not mine own.
Do you not think we are awake? It seems we sleep, we dream. Do you not think the Duke was here and bid us follow him?
Yea, hand my mother,
and Hippolyta.
And he did bid us follow to the temple.
Why then are we awake? Let us follow them, and by the way, let's recount our dreams.
When my cue comes, call me, and I will answer. My next is most fair Pyramus. I hope. Peter Quince, Flute the Fellow's Mender, Snout the Tinkerer, Starveling! God's my life, stolen hence and left me asleep. I have had a most rare vision. I have had a dream, past the wit of man, to say what dream it was. Man is but an ass if he go about to expound this dream. Methought I was. There is no man can tell what. Methought I wasn't. Methought I had, but man is a patched fool if he will to offer to say what methought I had. The eye of man hath not heard. The ear of man hath not seen. Man's tongue is not able to taste, nor his heart to report what my dream was. I will get Peter Quince to write a ballad of this dream, and it shall be called Bottom's Dream, for it hath no bottom. And I shall sing it at the latter end of the play, before the Duke. Preadventure, to make it more courteous, I shall sing it at her death.
Cannot be heard of. I wrote down he is transported.
If he come not, then the play is marred. It goes not forward, doth it?
It is not possible. There is not a man in all Athens able to discharge Pyramus but he.
though. He has simply the best wit of any handicraft man in Athens.
Yeah, and the best person, too. And he's a very paramour for a sweet voice.
Oh, sweet Holy Bottom. Thus hath he lost sixpence a day during his life. He could not escape sixpence a day. And the Duke had not given him sixpence a day for playing Pyramus, I'll be hanged. He would have deserved it, sixpence a day, and Pyramus or nothing.
Where are these lads? Where are these hearts?
Bottom, almost courageous day, almost happy hour.
Masters, I am to discharge wonders. Yet ask me not what, for if I tell you I am no true Athenian, I will tell you all, right as it fell out.
Let us hear, sweet Bottom.
Not a word from me. All I can tell you is, the Duke hath died. Get your apparel together. Good ribbons to your beards, new strings to your pumps, and meet presently at the palace. Every man look o'er his part, for the short and long is, or play is preferred. In any case, let him who play his be clean linen, and let not him who play the lion pare his nails, for they shall hang out as the lion's claws. And most dear actors, eat no onions or garlic, for we are to utter sweet bread. And I doubt not but to hear them say, it is a sweet comedy. Now no more words. Away! Go away!
It's strange, my Theseus, that these lovers speak of.
More strange than true. I never may believe these ancient fables nor these fairy toys. The poet's pen turns into shapes and gives the airy nothing a local habitation in the name. Or in the night, imagining some fear, how easy is a bush supposed to bear?
But all the story of the night pulled over, and to all their minds configured so together, more witness than fancy's images, and gross to some great constancy, but however so strange and admirable.
Here come the lovers, full of joy and mirth. Joy, gentle friends, joy and fresh days and love of company your hearts. Come now, where is our usual manager of mirth? What rose our hand? Is there no play to ease the anguish of a torturing hour? Come, illustrate.
Here, my Theseus.
The battle with the centaurs to be sung by an Athenian eunuch to the harp. Will none of that. The riot of tipsy bacchanals. The thrice three muses mourning for the death of learning, late deceased in beggary. A tedious brief scene of young Pyramus and his love Thisbe, very tragical mirth, merry and tragical, tedious and brief. That is, hot ice and wonder strange snow. How shall we find the comfort of this discord?
A play there is, my lord, some 10 words long, which is as brief as I have known a play. But by 10 words, my lord, it is too long, which makes it tedious. For within the play there is not one word apt, one player fitted, and tragical, my noble lord, it is. For Pyramus there is not kill himself, which when I saw rehearsed, I must confess me mine eyes water. But more merry tears, the passion of loud laughter never shed.
And what are they that do play it?
Hard-handed men that work in Athens here, which never labored in their minds till now, and now have toiled their unbreathed memories with this same play against your nuptial.
And we will hear it.
No, my noble lord, it is not for you. I have heard it over, and it is nothing, nothing in the world.
I will hear that play, and bring them in. Take your places, ladies.
Oh, I love not to see wretchedness, oh, charge. Duty and service perishing.
Gentle sweet, you shall see no such thing.
Since I can do nothing of this kind.
The kind are we to give them thanks for nothing?
So please your grace, the prologue is addressed.
Let him approach!
If we offend, it is with goodwill that you should think upon the Not to offend, but with goodwill, to show our simple skill that is the true beginning of our end. Consider then we come but in this fight. We do not come as minute to contest you. Our true intent is. All for your delight, we are not here. The actors are at hand, and by their show, you shall know all that you are like to know.
This fellow doth not stand upon points.
He hath read his prologue like a rough colt. He knows not to stop. A good moral, my lord, is not enough to speak, but to speak true.
Indeed, he hath played on his prologue like a child on a recorder, a sound but not in government.
Who is next?
Gentles, perchance you wonder at this show, but wonder on till truth makes all things plain. This man is Pyramus, if you would know. This beauteous lady. This man, with lime and rough cast, doth present walls. That vile wall which did these lovers sundered. And through walls chink, poor souls, they are content. At the which let no man wonder. This man with lanthorn, dog, and bush of thorns presenteth moonshine, for, if you will know, by moonshine do these lovers think no scorn to meet at Linus's tomb. There to woo. This grisly beast, with lion height by name, the trusty Thisbe, coming first by night, did scare away, or rather did affright. Her mantle she did fall. Which lion, vile with bloody mouth, did stain.
Now, fire through the wall. You will see it all go pat as I told you. Yonder she comes.
Oh, wolf! Wolf, hast thou heard my moans? For parting thy fair parents and me? My chariot flew off and kissed thy stones. Thy stones with a light and hair and in me.
I see a voice, now lie to the chink, to spy. And I can hear my Thisbe's face, all Thisbe.
My love, thou wilt, my love, my fate.
Fate what thou wilt, but I am thy lover's grace, and like Lymander, I am trusty still.
And I like Helen till the fates me kill.
Oh, not shackless opprobrious was so true.
Has shackless opprobrious I to you?
Oh, kiss me through the hole of this vile wall.
Oh, spite! But mark, poor knight, what dreadful dole is judgment dost thou, lion, frame? For lion vile hath here deflowered my dear. Which is? No, which was the fairest dame that lived, that loved, that liked, that looked with cheer? Ah, come, tears, get thou out, sword, and wound the pap of Pyramus. Thine left pap, my heart doth hop. Ah, thus died I, thus. Now am I fled, my soul is gone. Come loose, my mother, take thy flight. Now
find him by starlight. Here she comes, and her passion ends the play.
We think she should not use the long one for such a pyramid. I hope she will be brief.
Asleep, my love? What? Dead, my dove? Great pyramid, arise! Speak, quite dumb. Dead? A tomb must cover thy sweet eyes. These my lips, this cherry nose, these little
thank you.
snores, all with weary task foredone. Now the wasted brands do glow, and the screech owl, screeching loud, the wretch that lies to woe in remembrance of a shroud. Now it is the time of night that the graves all gaping wide, that every one lets forth his sprite in churchway paths to glide. And we fairies that do run by triple Hecate's team from the presence of the sun, following the darkness like a dream. Now we'll frolic. Not a mouse shall disturb this hallowed house, for I am sent with broom before to sweep the dust behind the door.
Did the house keep gathering light by the dead and drowsy fire? Every elf and fairy sprite pop as light as bird from briar.
Now hand in hand with fairy grace will we sing and bless this place.
Give me your hands if we be friends, and Robin shall restore amends.